Welcome to the AI4EU Cafe for live presentations around AI. The speaker today is Simon, and for me, Akis, Simon Papadopoulos from Certh in Greece. And with his talk on deepfakes, an emerging internet threat and their detection. My name is Carmen McWilliams, and I'm the moderator and organizer. And I'm also the director of the company Grassroots Arts and partner in the European AI4EU project and in the AI4MEDIA project. And so, as always, please take notice that this session will be recorded. No confidential information shall be shared in this cafe session. In this cafe, the speaker expresses their personal view and opinions. This is not necessarily the official AI4EU project opinion. So welcome, everybody. I see you're coming into the cafe. Great you're here today. This is our last cafe for 2020. But of course, in 2021, we continue. So thank you for being here. And what is this web cafe about? It offers a series of live web sessions which take place regularly. The cafe is an online forum to gain insight into the European AI scene, and participants get the chance to share knowledge and experience. Please notice this is interactive. So if you have questions to Simon Papadopoulos, our speaker today, then you can write down these questions in the chat and question panel on your right side. There's a control panel and you can write it in there. I will read your questions to the speaker. And now I will introduce our speaker today, our highlight, Simon Papadopoulos. Hello, do we hear you?
Hello.
Hello, great. Great. So from Greece today with us, Dr. Simon Papadopoulos is a senior researcher of the Information Technology Institute, ITI, Center for Research and Technology, Hellas, in short, Certh, in Thessaloniki, Greece. He holds an electrical and computer engineering diploma from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, a professional doctorate in engineering from the Technical University of Eindhoven, a master's in business administration from the Bleeking Institute of Technology, and a PhD in computer science from the Aristotle University of Thessalonica. Wow! His research interests lie at the intersection of multimedia understanding, social networks analysis, information retrieval, big data management, and artificial intelligence. Dr. Papadopoulos has co-authored more than 30 papers in referred journals, 10 book chapters, and 100 papers in international conferences, 3 patents, and has edited 2 books. He has participated in a number of relevant EC FP7 H2020 projects in the areas of media coverage, social media, and artificial intelligence, including We Verify, Helios, Future Pulse, Invit, Reveal, and Social Sensor. He currently coordinates the H2020 Mediaverse project and is a member of the coordinating team of the AI4MEDIA Network of Excellence. That's where we are partner in. During the last years, he has been leading the media verification team MeVer, focusing on the development of tools for the detection analysis of multimedia and social media-based disinformation. So this is impressive. Thank you. You are here today with us. Thank you. So, in short, I say, welcome, Akis. Hello, I give you now the moderator role, so you can introduce yourself, and you are now in the driving seat.
Thank you very much, Carmen, for this very kind words and the introduction, and for inviting me to give this talk on this hopefully interesting topic. I guess you already see my screen, right?
Yes, I see it.
Okay. So I will try to provide an overview presentation of the emerging problem of deepfakes and some approaches for their detection. Also, I will try to present our work and some practical lessons learned in our effort to develop and deliver a deepfake detection service. The work presented here is largely motivated by our team's involvement in two Horizon H2020 projects. And sorry, I think there's something. Okay. Namely, we verify an AI4MEDIA, which I will briefly introduce later in the talk. This is joint work with several people from the media verification team in our institute, who are listed here in the title slide. So let's get started. Before proceeding further, allow me to repeat some background information, which many of you likely already know. The term deepfakes originally appeared in 2017 when a Reddit user with the name Deepfakes started posting generated videos on a specific subreddit of mostly pornographic nature. Since then, they have gained wide popularity and they have been used for entertainment purposes as well as to spread disinformation and to commit fraud. Most of this talk focuses on face-related deepfakes, which is the most common form to date. Even though several of the approaches for deepfake creation and detection are in theory applicable to other types of content and domains, I'm not going to discuss any such aspects in the interest of time. Also, I'm not going to discuss about technologies that are aimed at preventing deepfakes, such as, for instance, verifying and tracking the provenance of media content, such as, for instance, using blockchain or the Content Authenticity Initiative. Even though the latter are quite important for the solution of the problem, they offer a largely different and complementary approach to the problem. The talk is organized in four main parts. First, I will try to contextualize this research area within a number of recent developments and events that have made the headlines. Next, I'll briefly introduce some basic information about deepfake generation technologies, while in the third part, I will try to present a few selected deepfake detection methods. In the last part, I will focus on our ongoing work on building a deepfake detection service. So let's first take a look at some important facts about deepfakes. Among the most well-cited business reports on the threat of deepfakes is the one by a Dutch company called Sensity, and previously known as Deep Trace Labs. This report, which was published more than a year ago, performed a quantitative study that identified what is claimed to be the bulk of deepfake content on the web. Following the same methodology as in a previous edition of this study, the researchers at Sensity measured an almost 100% increase in the number of deepfake videos online in less than a year. They also classified the vast majority of this content as pornographic and found evidence that this content achieved a large reach, given that a subset of them attracted more than 130 million views. Deepfakes have also attracted the attention of computer scientists in recent years, which is attested by the exponential growth of paper appearing on the subject. Just to give you an idea, it is estimated that more than 1,200 papers mentioned the term GAN in their title or abstract just in 2019, while more than 730 papers were published in 2020 and contained the term deepfake in their text. It is worth noting that the number of such papers before 2017 was close to zero. A recent major harmful use of deepfake technology brought to light by the same company, Sensity, involved the large-scale use of a Telegram bot to create nude images of women without their consent. It was found that more than 100,000 such images were publicly shared by the bot in several Telegram chat channels. Even though the bot is currently idle, it is believed that it has not been taken down by Telegram and that it is still operating under the radar. Perhaps the most popular application of deepfake technology is in the context of mobile apps that make it easy for everyone to swap faces with celebrities. Such an app is Zhao, which became really popular in the Chinese market. Besides attracting many users, the app quickly garnered negative press due to its very controversial user agreement. This gave the company behind the app the right to use any imagery created by the app for free for all purposes and with no option to revoke consent. Even though the company changed these controversial passages, the initial agreement is indicative of the privacy risks involved in using such technologies, as well as on the potentially harmful business models behind the creation of such apps. Following this trend, the Reface app, which can create compelling deepfakes of users, has also gained a lot of popularity. It currently has more than 25 million downloads in more than 100 countries. And it has essentially normalized the use of deepfakes by the public. It is worth noting that by using the app, people were already able to harass individuals, as for instance, in the case of an Indian filmmaker who one day opened his Instagram feed only to find photos of his face imposed onto objectionable images accompanied with homophobic slurs. Another serious deepfake related threat is the one of fake identities, which are set up typically with the intention to connect to target accounts and engage in online espionage activities. This was, for instance, the case of the here depicted image of Katie Jones, a LinkedIn fake profile created with the help of deepfake technology. This profile ultimately managed to get connected, among others, to a Deputy Assistant Secretary of State in the US, a senior aide to a senator, and a well-known economist. This fake profile turned out to be part of a large army of phantom profiles lurking on LinkedIn, as this Associated Press story describes. We've also seen two high-profile cases where deepfakes have allegedly been used in polarized settings, giving rise to risky tensions. In the first instance, Gabon President Ali Bongo, his long absence from the public sphere raised doubts about his well-being. After these doubts grew bigger, Gabon's government released a video, which according to opposing politicians was a deepfake. Even though there's no conclusive evidence about that, 1 week after the video release, Gabon's military attempted an ultimately unsuccessful coup. In the second incident, Malaysia's Minister of Economic Affairs was accused of adultery, which is still illegal in Malaysia, on the grounds of three videos that leaked through anonymous journalists on WhatsApp groups. These videos allegedly show the minister in intercourse with a young man. The minister denied the allegations, calling the video a fake. Mr. Nguyen, a digital forensics expert who analyzed the video, could not exclude the possibility of this video being a deepfake. So we can see that even with a suspicion of deepfake, we could have a political conflict and turmoil in some cases. It is rather surprising that in the recent US elections, there was no major deepfake incident involved, with the exception of the depicted Joe Biden deepfake, which was shared with obvious satiric or mocking purposes. So it clearly didn't have an intention to misinform. The reason why deepfakes were not employed during these elections is likely not because they aren't a threat, but it's actually because simple deceptions like selective editing or outright lies have worked just fine. Therefore, malicious actors opted for the readily available good old-fashioned misinformation methods. Yet this does not mean that the technology doesn't create risks for political misinformation, but it is likely that these will materialize in the future. Now let's get a quick idea about how some of the most common deepfake techniques work. A recent survey on the topic by Tolozana and colleagues defined four main types of face manipulation: entire face synthesis, attribute manipulation or editing, identity swap or replacement, or also known as face swap, and expression swap or facial reenactment. In addition to that survey, there are at least two more very comprehensive surveys on the topic, one by Bertoliva and another by Mirsky and Lee. The fact that there are at least three surveys on this area coming out this year is a clear indication that this topic is really important for the research community. Among the first approaches to detect, to create deepfakes was this encoder-decoder architecture. In this architecture, a single encoder model was shared between the source and target subject, while two distinct decoders were trained, one for the source and the other for the target. In theory, the encoder would learn to extract a representation that focuses on facial attributes and properties such as angle, skin tone, expression, and lighting, while each decoder would focus on person-specific and contextual features surrounding the face. Then, for performing the face swap, it would be sufficient to use the representation created by the encoder for an image of person A, and then decode that using the decoder for person B. This basic scheme suffers from several issues in terms of training and result quality. And it is for that reason that a number of more sophisticated network architectures have been proposed, including the very well-known generative adversarial networks, which are pairs of neural networks which work against each other, the generator G and the discriminator D. After training using an adversarial loss function, the generator learns to generate samples that are indistinguishable from the original distribution. Moreover, image translation frameworks such as PIX2PIX and CycleGANs are employed to further improve result quality. The PIX2PIX framework enables paired translations from one image domain to another. The generator part of the framework comprises an encoder-decoder convolutional network which keep connections between the encoder and decoder. These connections enable the network to generate high-fidelity images by bypassing the compression layers of the encoder when needed. CycleGAN improves further over PIX2PIX by lifting the requirement for paired training and ensuring better translation consistency by using two GANs that translate back and forth between two different domains, subject to a newly proposed cycle consistency loss. Additionally, recursive neural networks, including long short-term memory architectures and gate recurrent units, have been used to better handle the sequential nature and temporal consistency of generated videos. And beyond the underlying deep learning model, which lies at the core of this process, there are a number of image pre-processing and post-processing operations that can lead to better results, especially for the cases of face swap and face reenactment. These include face detection and cropping, facial landmark extraction, UV mapping, and blending to ensure that the result is as realistic and artifact-free as possible. Even after such improvements, deepfake generation typically faces different challenges. For instance, it is hard to generalize, and there is always a need for many training samples. Moreover, there's typically need for paired training, even though there are few methods such as CycleGAN that enable unpaired training. There is the risk of identity leakage, where features from the source identity transfer to the target individual, and it is particularly challenging to have occlusions. So, for instance, a hand in front of a face. Beyond the actual methods that are published in papers, there are now plenty of open source tools that tech-savvy people can play with in order to create deepfakes of potentially very high quality. provided, of course, they spend some effort in properly training models and manually improving the model outputs. These tools have drastically reduced the barriers to entry for non-experts to this technology, and we can therefore assume that adversaries and malicious actors have access to them. It is about 5 or 6 years that deepfake creation technologies such as GANs were first conceived, and yet the improvement in terms of how realistic the generated content looks is remarkable. This image, which was tweeted by the father of GANs, Ian Goodfellow, illustrates vividly this observation. Comparing the 2018 generated image with one of the first generated in 2014 and seeing the progress makes us wonder what will come next in a few years from today. It also makes clear why we need equally advanced detection methods. So let's get a glimpse into some deepfake detection methods which are so much needed. First, it is quite useful to know that the current state of deepfakes is such that in the majority of cases, one careful human observer can still tell deepfakes from authentic content with a bit of training. This illustration by the Associated Press highlights several parts of the deepfake that are worth closer inspection in order to spot deepfake artifacts or signs. The most common such artifacts include, for example, blurry or fuzzy background, blurry areas around lips, hair, and earlobes, different colors between the eyes, lack of symmetries and consistencies across the face, as well as lighting inconsistencies, among others. If you are interested in testing your skills, there are at least a couple of websites where you will be presented with pairs of images and will be asked to indicate the fake one. By playing a bit, you will soon become quite good at telling the two apart. Yet, this doesn't mean that it will still be possible through manual inspection to make confident decisions in the not too far future, when deepfake generation methods become even more sophisticated. It is for this reason that automated detection methods will become very important tools in the future. A first family of such automated detection methods try to emulate a human observer. In particular, they aim at extracting artifacts that are typical of deepfakes and then use these artifact-oriented features to classify the content in question. For instance, among the first such approaches is a method that tries to expose fake face videos using eye blinking as a physiological signal that is typically not well presented in synthetic videos. The method detects eye blinking in the videos using a long-term recurrent convolutional network around the eyes of the detected face. The method is tested over benchmarks of eye blinking detection dataset and also showed promising performance on detecting videos generated with the deepfakes generation model. Another physiological signal-based approach is the so-called fake catcher. The basic intuition behind this method is that the human pulse can be used as an implicit descriptor of authenticity, because it is neither spatially nor temporally preserved in fake content. So fake catcher processes input videos by collecting fixed length video segments with facial parts, defining regions of interest within each face, and extracting several biological signals from those regions in those temporal segments. The authors first scrutinize the pairwise separation problem where video pairs are given, but the fake video is not known in the pair. Based on this analysis, they formulate a solution by examining the extracted biological signals, their transformations to different domains, time frequency and time frequency, and their correlations. They then combine the insights from the pairwise context and interpretable feature extractors are used to develop a generalized authenticity classifier. They also develop a CNN-based classifier operating on biological signal maps. Fake catcher was experimentally demonstrated to result in high detection accuracy, even in videos found in the wild, that is videos that are not part of the benchmark datasets used to build the system. Another family of methods try to detect artifacts that result from the deepfake generation process. For instance, in this particular method, deepfakes are assumed to be created by splicing synthesized face region into the original image. And in doing so, they are expected to introduce errors that can be revealed when 3D head poses are estimated from the face image using 68 facial landmarks. The authors develop a conventional classification pipeline based on 3D head pose features and training an SVM classifier. Another class of methods try to detect artifacts that are the result of the deepfake generation process. Here are two such approaches. The first, which was proposed by Mattern and colleagues, is based on traditional machine learning models to detect artifacts in images generated from the deepfakes and face-to-face models. The employed classifiers try to spot features such as missing reflections around the eye and teeth areas, as well as dissimilarities in the colors of the left and the right eye. The second method is based on the observation that deepfake creation pipelines typically generate images of limited resolution, which needs to be further worked to match the original faces in the source video. Such transforms leave distinctive artifacts in the resulting videos, and the authors employ CNNs to capture them. The method tries to avoid the use of deepfake generated images as negative training examples by simulating them directly using simple image processing operations such as Gaussian blurring. In that way, it saves a lot of time from the training set creation process. Another well-known artifact-based approach is the so-called face X-ray. This analyzes an input face image and creates a grayscale image, revealing whether the input image can be decomposed into the blending of two images from different sources. It is based on the observation that most existing face manipulation methods use blending for combining the altered face with an existing background image. Face X-ray assumes the existence of a blending step and does not rely on any knowledge of the artifacts associated with a specific face manipulation technique. An advanced neural network architecture called HRNet is trained with generated fake images and masks by blending real images together. This approach works well for many deepfake manipulation techniques and was empirically shown to generalize well to new datasets. Obviously, it is not supposed to work for faces that are generated from scratch. A more general category of approaches follow the more traditional binary classification setting. This makes specific adaptations to optimize performance on the deepfake detection task. For example, MesoNet is designed to focus on the mesoscopic features of an image using a shallow network architecture. ExceptionNet is a deeper classification network used in many classification tasks that turns out to perform better than MesoNet in the deepfake detection problem. Finally, capsule networks that are also used in many classification tasks apply the capsule architecture on the deepfake problem. Depending on the training data, these networks can detect a lot of state-of-the-art deepfake generation approaches, but it is reasonable to also expect that their performance will be largely dataset dependent. Another recent approach proposed by Sabir and colleagues aims to detect inconsistencies in the temporal dimension of deepfake videos. To this end, the authors propose a two-step architecture where in the first step, features are extracted for each face per frame with a convolutional neural network. Then a recurrent neural network is used to process the sequence of these features. The authors experiment with different variants of the RNN architecture, for instance, a single RNN on top of the final features, or multiple recurrent neural networks at different levels of the hierarchy of the backbone network. In addition, the authors explore face alignment methods to remove other confounding factors related to the rigid motion of the face in a video. They experimentally find that this method is effective in detecting deepfakes from different models, such as deepfake face-to-face and face swap. And another family of approaches operate on the frequency domain, as frequency provides a complementary space where subtle forgery artifacts or compression errors could be well distinguished. In the approach illustrated here, the authors propose a novel frequency in face forgery network, taking advantages of two different but complementary frequency-aware clues: frequency-aware decomposed image components and local frequency statistics. More specifically, the frequency-aware decomposition, also called FAD, aims at learning frequency-aware forgery patterns through frequency-aware image decomposition. The FAD module adaptively partitions the input image in the frequency domain according to learnable frequency bands and represents the image with a series of frequency-aware components. The local frequency statistics module extracts local statistics to describe the discrepancy between real and fake faces. The localized frequency statistics not only reveal the unusual statistics of the forgery image at each frequency band, but also share the structure of natural images, and therefore they can enable effective mining through convolutional neural networks. The proposed framework collaboratively learns the frequency-aware clues from FAD and LFS by a cross-attention two-stream network, which the authors call MixBlock. Here are two more works, and these are the final works I'm going to present, that investigate the role of frequency analysis on deepfake detection. In the first, the authors investigate whether it is possible to create a universal detector for telling apart real images from those generated by a convolutional neural network, regardless of the architecture or dataset used. To test this, the authors collect a dataset consisting of fake images generated by 11 different CNN-based image generator models, chosen to represent the space of commonly used architectures today. For instance, ProGAN, StyleGAN, BigGAN, CycleGAN, StarGAN, and the like. They demonstrate that with careful pre- and post-processing and data augmentation, a standard image classifier trained on only one specific generator, namely ProGAN, is able to generalize surprisingly well to unseen architectures, datasets, and training methods. Their findings suggest the intriguing possibility that today's CNN-generated images share some common systematic flaws, preventing them from achieving realistic image synthesis in the frequency domain. In the second of the two works, authors try to exploit GAN-based architectures that are relying on convolution-based upsampling methods to produce images or videos. They show that common upsampling methods, known as upconvolution or transposed convolution, are causing the inability of such models to reproduce spectral distributions of natural training data correctly. This effect is independent of the underlying architecture, and the authors show that it can be used to easily detect generated data like deepfakes with high accuracy on public benchmark datasets. They also propose to add a novel spectral regularization term to the training optimization objective. These approaches can be applied to most deepfake datasets, but also to fully synthetic faces. Having presented a few deepfake detection methods, it is worth having a look at how they perform in the state-of-the-art benchmark datasets. This includes the methods presented in the previous slides and focuses on the Face Forensics Plus dataset, which is among the most popular benchmarks in the area. There are some variations of the dataset, which are marked in the respective column. What we can quickly observe from a look at the performance scores in terms of both area under the curve and accuracy scores is that several of the methods essentially solve the problem in this dataset. That is, they are highly accurate, for instance, achieving and under the CERF score of 0.99 and an accuracy of 99%. So one could say that there's real progress in the field and that deepfakes may not be such an important concern after all. The answer to that comes when we see the performance achieved in the hidden set of the deepfake detection challenge. This table presents the top five methods among the more than 2,100 participating in the challenge. As we can see, there is a really big decrease in performance in terms of log loss error between the part of the dataset that was not known to participant, that is the first column, and the publicly accessible part, which is shown in the second column. Moreover, from the reported precision scores at different recall levels, we can see that the methods suffer from a rather high amount of false positives, which makes them hard to deploy in practice, given the fact that the percentage of deepfakes over the whole set of media items on the internet would be really small. And with that, moving to the last part of the talk, where I will try to give a glimpse of our ongoing efforts to build a deepfake detection service. We are doing much of our work in this area in the context of two Horizon 2020 projects, We Verify and AI for Media. We Verify has a more problem-driven and practical focus, while AI for Media, which started only a couple of months ago, is more research-oriented. It aims at more groundbreaking results. We Verify started at the end of 2018 with the goal of developing tools that help expose misleading content and tackle disinformation on social media. A key outcome of the project is a platform for collaborative content verification, tracking and debunking, and as part of this platform, we have been developing a deepfake detection service. Coincidentally, at the outset of our activity, the deepfake detection challenge was announced, so we decided to participate in order to delve into the problem. The goal of the challenge was to seek the best solutions for detecting videos that contain facial and voice manipulations. The challenge was organized by Amazon Web Services, Facebook, Microsoft, the Partnership on AI's Media Integrity Steering Committee, and several academics. Until the submission deadline last April, more than 2,200 teams registered and participated in it. Challenge participants needed to submit their code into a black box environment for testing, and then results were presented in a public leaderboard. Participants could submit several times their solutions, and each time they could see what was their performance in terms of log loss error against the so-called public test set. This set was not actually public, but the performance of the submitted solution on it was immediately made public in the challenge leaderboard. At the end of the challenge, participants needed to select two of their solutions for participating in the final ranking. This happened by applying them on a completely independent and hidden dataset. The resulting private leaderboard was the one used to rank the solutions and select the winners. Among the 2,114 competing teams, ours was ranked 49th in the public leaderboard and 115th in the private leaderboard, which was among the top 5% of the solutions. The deepfake detection challenge dataset is quite special compared to previous deepfake datasets, both due to its size and number of different subjects, both at least one order of magnitude larger than the second largest dataset to date, and due to the fact that all subjects in the videos were paid actors who gave their consent for the recordings to be used for that purpose. The dataset consisted of more than 119,000 10-second video clips. Of those, 100,000 clips contained deepfakes using one of the following models: deepfake, autoencoder, morphable mask model, the neural talking head model, the FSGAN method, and the method based on StyleGAN. This variety of models was considered by the organizers as representative of the state-of-the-art deepfake generation technologies at the time of the challenge. Instead, the hit and test set included many more types of fake content, both resulting from data augmentation, but also sourced from organic internet sources. A key component in the actual solution that we developed is a face extraction library, as the model training is focused around the face. Given that all face extraction libraries generate a number of false positives, one may understand that this can be a source of noise in the training data. Here is a sample of faces extracted from some sample clips at one frame per second using the MTCNN face detection library. One can note that there is a small but noticeable portion of false detections, but overall the true detections per video are considerably more. With this observation in mind, we devised the following filtering approach. Our goal was to cluster extracted faces around same face clusters in order to drop small clusters. To this end, we first compute face embeddings for each detected face in the video, and then build a face similarity graph by computing all pairwise face similarities among the respective embeddings and maintaining only edges that connect face embeddings of a sufficiently high similarity using an empirically selected threshold. We found that the resulting graph is naturally organized into connected components. Large connected components correspond to the main faces depicted in the video clips, while the small components often correspond to false face detections. Therefore, we filter out small components using a heuristic rule. As you may have noted, this is a pretty straightforward and simple approach, which means it is very easy to apply on top of any deepfake detection training process. Additionally, there's no need to manually tune the face extraction library in order to reduce the number of false positives. Finally, a positive side effect of the method is that it organizes the detected face instances in a video clip around face identities, which is useful when multiple persons are shown in the same video and the analysis process treats each person separately. To investigate the effectiveness of our approach, we used it in combination with different models and on different test datasets. Specifically, we trained multiple deepfake detection models on the training set of the challenge with and without the proposed preprocessing approach. And we tested them on three established benchmark datasets, CelebDF, Face Forensics++, and the subset of the dataset that was released by the challenge organizers. We also experimented with different ways of aggregating different frame predictions into a video level prediction. In this slide, I just present the results of the EfficientNet B4 model using two aggregation methods, but we've done more experiments using the well-known MesoInception 4 and the ExceptionNet models, as well as two more aggregation schemes. In all cases, we noticed that the proposed pre-processing step leads to a measurable reduction in the deepfake detection error in the order of 5%. Of course, this pre-processing step was just a small part of the whole training pipeline and solution, and there are really many different details and practical aspects that needed care in order to end up with a high-performing system. In addition to the proposed filtering approach, we observed the detection performance and robustness benefited a lot from a face augmentation step. This involved different transformations, including horizontal and vertical flip, random cropping, rotation, image compression, Gaussian and motion blurring, brightness, saturation, and contrast transformations. We also used an ensemble of three models, EfficientNet B3, EfficientNet B4, and I3D, averaging their predictions, and on each of those models, we added two dense layers with dropout after the backbone architecture. At inference time, we again first applied the previously presented pre-processing approach and obtained the components that correspond to different faces in the videos. We then extract 48 uniformly sampled frames from the video and use the trained models to get predictions per detected face. We average model predictions for each face component and model in cases of multiple faces. We output the maximum prediction among the aggregated face predictions as the final prediction for the video. After the challenge, we had the opportunity to study the details of some of the best performing methods, and we made the following observations. First, most approaches used ensembles of efficient net architectures, all of them, from B3 to B7. But ResNext was another architecture that was used by top performing solutions combined with 3D architectures such as i3D, 3D ResNet, and MC3. A very simple heuristic that seemed to work well was to increase the margin around the detected bounding box around the face. In our solution, we used a 20% additional margin, but it seemed that even bigger values could benefit the solution. Also, to improve the generalization performance, some additional domain-specific augmentations proved to be beneficial. For instance, half-face removal, be that horizontal or vertical, landmark removal, and even mix-up augmentations. Trying to summarize the practical challenges we faced, the most important one seems to be the limited generalization ability of the model. This observation applies to all participants of the challenge, as the winning team scored, for instance, 0.2 approximately log loss error in the public validation set, but only 0.42 or 43 in the private one. Overfitting seemed to also be a big issue for some participants. For instance, the top method in the public leaderboard scored 0.19 in terms of log loss error, but in the private leaderboard, this increased to 0.57, which made the solution drop below the 900th position. Finally, the cause of these challenges is that the problem of deepfake detection has a very broad scope, including many different types of manipulations in generative models. Given the adversarial nature of the problem, we are almost certain to have access to only a subset of the types of manipulation at training time. We are currently facing a few more challenges in our effort to deploy the deepfake detection service. First of all, videos sourced from the internet may contain multiple scenes and shots, and only a subset of those may contain a deepfake. Processing and aggregating the results per scene can significantly slow down our service and also makes it harder to present in an easy way to end users. Also, it seems that the bulk of social media videos are of low quality. Low quality faces tend to fool classifiers, at least the models that we have built so far. Other challenging cases include small and fast moving faces, while changes in illumination and moving objects in front of faces pose additional challenges to the model. Therefore, robustly handling the variety of internet content seems to be a really big task that we have ahead of us. We have recently released to our project partners in WeVerify an alpha version of our deepfake detection service. And this is currently undergoing testing with our media partners at Agence France Press and Deutsche Welle. It is still not publicly available, but if some of you are interested, please drop me an email and we could grant you test access. And with that, I would like to really thank you for your attention and patience. Here you can find my contact information and the website and Twitter account of our team. Let me also take the opportunity to wish you to stay healthy and have a good time during the Christmas holidays. And then let's hope that next year will be happier than this one.
Thank you. Thank you, Akis, for this really great presentation. And yes, it was a deep insight into deep fake detection. So, yes. And as always, I have the first question, and then we have also a question from the audience. So everybody who still has a question, please type them in because I'm going to read them to Akis. My first question is, how does deepfake detection contribute to the overall area of trustworthy AI?
I think deepfake detection is among some very central topics in trustworthy AI. Since this very general technology is responsible for generating deepfakes, and so it could potentially be abused by malicious actors. And then we also turn to AI and trustworthy AI to provide a solution to the problem. Of course, it's a kind of an arms race where new attack models make the deepfake detection solutions rather obsolete. But I think that it is certainly a very crucial and important research direction in terms of building trustworthy AI systems.
Okay, thank you. I think this directly leads to the question of Bertrand Braunschweig. Thank you, Akis, for this very nice presentation. For me, this resembles an arms race. More sophisticated deepfakes leads to more sophisticated detection methods, leads to even more sophisticated deepfakes, etc. How can this end?
Yes, yes, this is very true. And there is definitely this element very prominent in this area, partly, you know, because these deepfake generation models inherently have this adversarial nature implemented. For instance, the guns, which are well known to everyone, use this kind of arms race between two networks to continuously improve the generator, but also the detector. There are, of course, also techniques that try to go beyond this adversarial game. For instance, trying to extract biological or physiological markers from the depicted faces. And typically these markers, like the human pulse or the eye blinking, are very hard, at least by existing methods, to really simulate and synthesize. Also, methods that operate on the frequency domain are quite more robust compared to more supervised learning methods that rely on some training data set. So there is some hope that also there are solutions and detection methods that can solve the problem. There are also, as I mentioned in the very beginning of the talk, other completely different approaches that try to essentially embed provenance information in media content, and such as, for instance, using blockchain, or such as the recently proposed content authenticity initiative. Those, if they are adopted at a very large scale, are also a step forward to this solution.
Okay, thank you. Here, a lot of questions are coming in. Great. We have a very, very active audience here. So first, a very easy one, just for Audi. Gilbert, just show the previous slide. Can you just go back?
This one?
Yeah, so super. That was already here. Thank you. So anyway, who wants to have the slides, please write directly to Akis. He may share it. I mean, it's up to you, Akis. No? I sent you the...
Sure. I plan to publish them anyway. And if you want, you can also follow this Twitter account, either mine or the media verification teams, and I will definitely post there when I publish them.
Great. So, question, Kai Zalmela. Thank you for this presentation. Where can I learn more about the fake voice detection?
Oh, the fake voice detection. Here, to be honest, I'm not a real expert, because our work so far has focused on the image and video generation part, but I think that some of the survey papers that I mentioned in the previous slides contain pointers to also to audio based generation methods. Also, the deepfake detection challenge also had some parts of the data set where the audio was generated. But other than that, I'm afraid I cannot be of much use to this particular question.
Yes. So next one, Alexei Kirinchenko. Have there been experiments with ensembling multiple detection methods?
Yes, indeed. Actually, you mean completely different. I'm not aware of a very specific work. What we did in our solution was to make an ensemble over different neural network architectures. But this is perhaps not exactly what was asked. I'm sure that others have also tried ensembling completely different approaches. The main issue, of course, with ensembling very different methods is first that there is additional computational cost involved. So if you really want to deploy this in production, you might find it challenging. And also the fact that there is really a very wide variety of deepfake generation models would make some models or some methods perform well for different instances of each of the data. So the ensemble would need to be very smart in order to not, you know, be very sensitive to the input data. But I'm sure it's a promising direction, and it would definitely need more research.
Okay, thank you. Now we're coming in slowly to the end, yes, as time is passing. Sandro Sapiti asked. I hear you.
Could you repeat the last?
Yes. Many applications of deepfake so far seem to be malicious. Are there applications of deepfake for the good?
Yes, certainly. Actually, I believe that the original purpose of researchers was definitely benevolent and not malicious. So the deepfakes find very positive uses in the creative industries. So they can be used in making more cost-effective the media production. Currently, you can also see a lot of content that is deepfake generated that is, you know, purely for entertainment purposes. There are channels on YouTube that publish such content. There are even also some other niche applications, like for instance, face swapping used to replace faces of people in videos with the purpose of protecting their identity, but still making the video more pleasant to watch compared to just putting a square box in front of the face. So there are definitely many positive applications as well.
Yes, I think this basically has the main roundup now, because that was also Raya Shatila's question. Are there more positive, useful applications for deepfakes? So that is basically the same. There was like a hope for useful, no? Yeah. So, and then now the last, that's the last question, and that's basically nobody. Please send the questions afterwards by email. And that's all, the last thing. Max Skin says, Max here from Luxembourg. I'm sorry, could you repeat the mail address to get the presentation? Many thanks for your work. So this is really the last. So the
email address?
Yeah.
Is my slide still visible? Because it's...
it at papadop@iti.pr. yes, so that's basically there, you can get it, and if you forget it, then you just reply to my email, my invitation email, and I forward it to Akis. So very, very easy. I think it's now time to close this cafe for today. I must say this was great. Thank you, Akis.
Thank you also. And again, have a great holiday soon. Yes. And happy New Year.
Yes, happy Christmas, happy holidays, happy New Year. And see you, hopefully, everybody back in the cafe in the 2021. We restart in February, not January. We need a little rest and make our website more beautiful and everything more beautiful. And then you will get automatically the invitations for the next cafe. So again, thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.